Good evening, hockey fans, and welcome to the Houston Fieldhouse for tonight's ECAC hockey matchup between the fourth-ranked Bobcats of Quinnipiac University and the Engineers of RPI. My name is Perilous Garris, along with the coach, Dan Fridgen, bringing you all the action. You're home for RPI hockey, RPI TV, and ESPN Plus here in 21-22. The Engineers come in at 6-7-2 overall, 3-3-0 in ECAC hockey play. The Bobcats are 10-1-3, 3-0-1 in the league. RPI coming off of a couple of real tight one-goal losses to Northeastern last week, a real playoff atmosphere type games, Coach. I was at the Sunday game, actually both of them, I guess, because we were here on Friday, but they played real well. They had a lead going to the third period on Sunday, but weren't able to pull out a win in either game.
Yeah, just based on what I was reading, looks like they played solid the first two periods, and then it seemed like Northeastern came out with a sense of urgency, scored early in the third, and then got another one later in the game. But, I mean, that's that old cliche, you got to play 60 minutes, but, you know, you also got to take into consideration how the opposition responds, especially when they're on their home ice. And when they raise that level of urgency, you've got to respond.
Longest unbeaten streak in the conference for Quinnipiac, 9 games unbeaten here. They last lost, their only loss of the year was to number 6 North Dakota at home back on October 23rd. So a tough team to play, especially right now when this series has been actually pretty tight throughout the years. We'll get to that as we move along here, as it's the Bobcats in blue and gold here taking on the Engineers and their home whites. In the corner, it's Ethan DeYoung, senior from North Vancouver, British Columbia, working it back to the point. There's a quick snapshot high and wide. That came off the stick of Ivari Rassinen, a sophomore from Tampere, Finland. Outlet pass looking for Otto Ville-Lampinen. The Engineer is moving into the zone. He's all by himself. He'll spin it into the middle of the ice where it's intercepted by Zach Metsa. And it'll be shot all the way down. The Bobcats were in the middle of a change there, so they'll have to send those folks back out there. Not quite a minute gone here in the first period.
Quinnipiac comes in tonight 5-0-1 in the month of December in their last 6 games. RPI 1-4-1 in their last 6 since November 12th.
In goal, it's Yaniv Peretz, freshman from Quebec. He has a shutout in almost half of his starts here as a freshman. 4 of them in 9 games. He has a 1.06 goals against and a .939 save percentage. Here's Shane Seller. Tried to take a shot. It was tapped right back to him by Rassinen. Now back to the point. Hallbauer takes a shot through traffic. It goes wide. It'll leave the zone. It'll be claimed there by Laurie Surdy. Right back in. The Engineers dump it in as Peretz will play. Leaving it behind for Metsa. First meeting of the year between these two teams. They also square off in February. In Hamden, chipped off the boards and into the zone, off the stick of Gus Van Ness. And now Beaton takes a look. He'll lob it up the boards. Mendel can't control. Now Brackett moves ahead with it. Poked away from him by Skylar Brindamore. Now the junior will shoot it deep. Brindamore again behind the goal. Chow. And it's poked away from Brindamore by the grad student, Anthony Baxter. Now Chow has it behind the goal. Trying to throw it in front. Good defensive positioning there by Baxter to intercept. Now Brackett has it stripped away momentarily. Van Ness gets wrapped up there. And now Chow has it pinned against the boards with Mason Klee. Good to see Mason back in the lineup. Shot deep. It's past Van Ness and all the way around. Quinnipiac trying to change here with the puck in the zone, but RPI is able to break to center, and it's Jake Gagneau, sophomore from Pointe Claire, Quebec, shooting it in. Not quite 3 minutes gone here. As the puck is shot back into the Quinnipiac zone, they're going to whistle this one dead. I think for offside, I thought it was played by a Bobcat, but I could be wrong. Coach, not a bad start for the Engineers here.
No, not at all. They're skating. Both teams are skating at this point. They really haven't had much puck possession in either zone so far.
Face off at neutral ice. Bobcats have it. Chorney shoots it across. Now played through the middle and whacked deep by sophomore Ty Simlanic. Draft choice of the Florida Panthers, who are having a great start to their season in the NHL. This will be wrapped around. Laca tried to chop at it. Johnson has it, shoots it off the boards. Dubinsky picks it up, and he'll carry on further for Lampinen. Now Dubinsky gets knocked down into the zone. The Bobcat, that was Bongiovanni, lost his stick in making that hit. And Quinnipiac will reset in the neutral zone. It's Chorney. Wrapped around. It's going to be Marshall to play it. Another quick change for the Bobcats. RPI moving to center. Schreifels. McIsaac going to try and chase this down, but he's beaten to it by the former University of Denver pioneer, Griffin Mendel. Mendel clears the zone. And now Lee takes a hit, but works it cross ice for Mendel. Shoots it in. It hits off a Hallbauer. There it's played by Cipollone. Joey Cipollone, a junior from Purchase, New York. Back to the point. This is Jaden Lee. Fanning on the shot was Mendel, picked up by Adamo. And the RPI fourth line moves it to center ice. Here's Schreifel, circle, takes a shot over the shoulder. As Peretz may have gotten a piece of that. Picked up by Schreifels again. Nice pass down low. This is Adamo trying to feed it out in front. Bouncing puck. Hit a leg. It'll be cleared off the glass and all the way down. Will it be icing? Yes, they blow it. Thought they might wave that one off late. 15:30 to go, first period. No score here between Quinnipiac, the number four team in the country, and RPI, but the Engineers with an early look there.
You mentioned Smolanic earlier. He just got invited to the U.S. National Junior Team.
Always a great honor to play for your country. Quinnipiac leads the all-time series, 18 wins, 8 RPI victories, and they've tied 9 times. These two teams tie about a little over 30% of the time, Coach, which is a lot. Well, fortunately or unfortunately, that won't happen tonight by ECAC rule. There would be a shootout now, so they can't really tie as far as the ECAC is concerned. In the NCAA, going through overtime, 5 minutes, still tied will be officially a tie, but then the shootout will decide things for an extra point in the league. So for all those folks that were looking forward to another Quinnipiac RPI tie, it's not going to happen tonight. Mason Klee back at center, chips it off the wall. Tour Linden goes backwards with it. Now here's Anthony Baxter. He'll ring it in. Former UMass Lowell River Hawk. Good hit there on Rassinen. The Engineers win it back to the point. Here's Baxter. Klee, wrister wide, just looking to keep that one in. It'll be Tour Linden, who had his 12-game point streak ended at Northeastern on Sunday. He's still RPI's point leader on the year. Here's a slap shot. Baxter hit a body. Tap to the corner as Shane Steller was trying to find it. And this will be a hand pass. Oh, they wave it off. Baxter, a shot. It's tip wide. Not surely they're going to whistle that one down as it came off the, it looked like the hand of Linden and right to a teammate. But no, Baxter off of Nick Bowman, who's the extra forward tonight for RPI. Now, backtracking a bit there was Agnew. He'll turn it right back up ice behind his own goal. It's Peretz. Good play by Bowman. And now behind the goal, this is Brackett, who picked up his first collegiate goal on Sunday, the only goal for RPI in their 2-1 loss to number 18 Northeastern there. Now it's flipped towards the line, kicked to center by Beaton, and on comes Baxter, trying to hand it off to Bowman, but he had stopped at the blue line and allows Metza to take over. Metza again off the glass and out to center ice. Jake Johnson has it there. He'll go D-to-D in the neutral zone for Agnew to shoot it in. Former Boston College Eagle is Jack Agnew, sophomore from Oakville, Ontario. Bobcats moving out to center ice. This is Oliver Chow to start things from a standstill. Lost the puck to Lampinen. Lampinen across for Surdy. Surdy, a shot! That one caught the outside of the iron, although it may have caught the arm of Peretz as well. Here's Hallbauer keeping it in. Off the back of the net. Lampinen trying to track it down. It does. Aspu, Finland native, trying to send it in front. Shot by Laca. Another shot by Lampinen. And that one's turned away by Peretz as well. Engineers with some early chances here in this first period. Racking up the shots on goal.
Good couple of opportunities there for RPI. Right on the doorstep.
Shot in. by James McIsaac. And now McIsaac gets it back, looking to center. Schreifels spinning with it, sends it back to the point. Klee, a long shot. That takes a deflection to the circle. Baxter right back down low for Adamo. Justin Adamo throws it back to the point, and stripping Klee was Lombardi. He's back the other way. Lombardi walking in, and he scores. A wonderful move there by Michael Lombardi to pick up his fourth goal of the year, a senior from Barrington, Rhode Island. As looked like one of the engineers got caught in the celebration there. I think Baxter, and they had to be separated. But after RPI knocked on the door for a good 30 seconds there, Coach, the Bobcats take it back the other way and score a real nice goal. Look at it there.
Yeah, it looks like that play was created at the offensive blue line. RPI D kind of loses it a bit, and he takes it from the neutral zone all the way down. Makes a real good play on Marshall.
Yeah, Baxter tried to get back in the play there. He just couldn't lift the stick in time.
Yeah.
Johnson ahead. This will be tipped off the netting, and we'll get another stoppage here. Center ice draw here. Shots are 3-3. It's an early 1-0 lead for Quinnipiac. Almost against the run of play.
Penalty coming up on RPI.
Yeah, you're right about that.
Looks like Linden's going
to go. Is he holding?
No, I think Tura Linden's going to go for a slash.
Oh, slash. Okay, yeah, I read that wrong. Or saw the sign wrong. So Tura Linden to the penalty box for RPI. They'll go on the kill. Power play for the Bobcats, 13.8%, about middle of the road there. RPI's penalty kill sitting at 87.3%, 48 out of 55. They did not take a penalty on Sunday in Boston, and they only took one penalty on Friday against Northeastern. They're going to redo this faceoff. More of what we saw last year, or the 1920 season for RPI, where they were one of the least penalized teams in the country. After some early penalty trouble this year, they've certainly cut down in that department, which is good to see. I think we have an issue with the scoreboard. Referees are over there.
Well, they do pretty well on the penalty kill as well. So
yeah. No, 87% is good.
Yeah, when you do take a penalty, at least you know that your killers are going to go out there and get the job done.
Referees tonight are Anthony Kenny and Ryan Sweeney. The linesmen are Adam Wood and Taylor Larson, not to be confused with RPI Women's Hockey Defender Taylor Larson, who is currently in Hanover, New Hampshire, as the women are taking on Dartmouth, and they're tied 1-1 in the second period up there.
I don't know what the delay could be.
I don't know.
Here.
The penalty's on the board.
Yeah. I don't know. They're always questioning, you know, time on the clock.
Okay.
Whether it's right or.
I don't know. We don't know what's going on, but we do know we're going to play hockey again. And that's the important thing. Face-off win for the Bobcats. Back to the point. This is Metza to the slot. A one-timer by Bongiovanni, the captain, and that one stopped by Marshall right in the chest. It hit him. Now Smolanic, Metza, Chow. Metza, Chow. Looking to the middle. That was Smolanic. He was tied up by two engineers, and the Bobcats keep it in. Wyatt Bongiovanni, senior from Birmingham, Michigan. Good hit in the corner there. The puck comes free to Chow. Back to the point. Bongiovanni looking for an angle. Sends it to the far circle. Metza hands it off to Chow. Trying to go back door. It was broken up by the engineers. Surdy knocks his man down, and now Dubinsky has a chance to clear, and he does down the ice.
It's always tough to play defensively against a power play like Quinnipiac because they move the puck so well. You try to be aggressive, then it'll tic-tac-toe you. As you can see there, they don't waste very much time getting that pass to the middle, taking that shot.
Here's Lee. A little give and go with Lombardi, the goal scorer. Pick up his fourth to get the scoring started in this game. Bochum hands it off there. And Goss throw it right through Lee. Picked up on the point. Now Lee again. Van Ness, 35 to go on the first power play of the game. Lee across, one-timer save, Marshall. And he stopped it between his pads and held on for a whistle with 25 to go on the man advantage.
Good job by RPI defensively. They're staying in the shooting lanes. As you can see, Quinnipiac has to adjust a little bit, pull that top forward out a little bit higher and opened up the flank for that one-time shot.
Face-off win for Quinnipiac again. They've done a good job in the circle so far tonight. Here's Lee. Back to the far side, into the middle. A little give and go with Filion, and now Ness. Into the middle, and they don't connect, and Lampinen will clear it down. Forcing Quinnipiac to start over once more. 4 seconds to go. That'll do it for the power play. Engineers 1-for-1 on the kill. It was a big kill early in this game, already down by one. Friedman to the middle and a glove save. As Marshall denies Mendel there. Grad student from Kelowna, British Columbia. And that'll get us our midway stoppage here in the first period. 1-0. Number 4, Quinnipiac leading RPI here on RPI TV and ESPN. Coach Dan Frigin is with me as always here. And big weekend here for RPI hockey before they have their big league break, but they're headed to Alaska for 4 games.
Yeah, that'll be a fun trip. It's always nice to go out there. They have University of Alaska always has real nice a support staff out there that helps the visiting teams. And, I remember when we went out there, I think it was in 2004, 2003. They really took good care of us, brought some salmon, wild salmon. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah,
it's great.
Seems like every travel story with the hockey ends up talking about food, Coach.
Yeah.
I don't disagree host. With. Yeah, I know. I want some of that fish.
Oh, it's delicious. Well, you mentioned earlier about the face-offs with Quinnipiac. There's a reason why they're winning most of the draws. They lead the nation, winning 58% of their face-off draws.
They've won 5 and lost 4 tonight. So RPI's leading in the face-off circle, 5-4. Shots are 6-3 Quinnipiac right now. As we're almost exactly halfway through the first period, and now we're ready for more hockey here. Face-off win again here. This is RPI's victory. Bracket. Back to the point. Spallone, a shot. And that one not hard for Marshall to save if he saw it, and he did pretty clearly, it looks. Another draw coming up in the RPI end. Another look at the shot there.
Yeah, he's been playing well. He sees this all the way in the net. Yep.
Who was that? That was Ethan Lay.
Coach didn't like that matchup.
Yeah. Friedman against Dubinsky on the draw. Couple of Midwesterners there. Friedman's from St. Louis, Missouri. And Dubinsky's from outside of Chicago, Illinois. Here's Jacob Laca. Good to see Jacob back in the lineup after a bit of a bout with an injury there. It'll be rung around. Dubinsky goes down, trying to pick it up. Tap back to the circle. Oh, just missed Laca, but got a penalty coming up. It's going to be a trip, and RPI will have its first power play with 9:24 to go in the first period.
Well, here's a good opportunity for RPI. See if they can build some momentum off the kill that they just had. And Tuur Linden picks the right side for the faceoff, which makes sense. Being a right-hand shot, he can either go to the net with it or draw it back on his backhand.
Face-off will be tapped to the near wall. Pinching there was Beaton. Thought it was the D-man moving up, but it was Beaton on the play. Now here's Seller. Back to the point. This is Hallbauer. Beaton on the far side. Hallbauer, center blue line. Now Linden, a shot and a blocker save by Peretz. And the Bobcats clear it all the way down the ice. Decent crowd here, Coach, as the fans have been filing in as this first period has gone along.
As they usually do on a Friday night.
Much better than over the, I guess, the holiday weekend against Northeastern on that Friday. Tough to get a crowd there. Here's Hallbauer at the middle of the slot. Pulls it back and takes a shot through a screen. It was Seller in front. Here's Beaton across. Looking down low for the tip from Laka. And he put it wide on the redirect. Good idea there from Linden. And now shorthanded comes Quinnipiac. And it's Mendel. He'll shoot it down.
That was a good play. Just missed from behind the net. Looking for that guy in front.
37 seconds to go in the power play. Dubinsky hands it off for Adamo, getting it in deep for Dubinsky. Dubinsky lost his man, actually went to the ice. That was Rassinen. But the Bobcats were able to clear it down again. Quinnipiac with a 7-4 shot advantage. Here's Lepinen breaking ahead. Again to Adamo at the wall. Drops it off to Dubinsky. Johnson, wrist shot coming, and a blocker save again by Peretz. Adamo back to the point. Johnson keeps it in. Chorney out of the box, strips him of the puck. But that's all they could do. Or Cipollone, excuse me. Could have been disastrous there, but Johnson was able to get that pass away. And now it'll be flipped out of play. And we get a stoppage with 7:10 to go in the period. So RPI able to set up that power play, get a couple of decent looks at the net, but again, some stuff kept to the outside there by the Bobcats penalty kill.
Yeah, they look good on that power play. They're moving the puck well. Get some opportunities. And you're right, Johnson was very lucky. He was right almost where
on the penalty box there.
Quinnipiac player comes out of the box, and that would have been ugly.
I'm sure someone from the bench for RPI was shouting at him, so he knew he had to get that puck away. Now thrown in front, that was Chow. A fortuitous bounce for him, but he couldn't get the shot off. It just fell to him at the side of the net, but
he might have knocked that out of the air.
He might have, but in the end, he couldn't even steer one on goal. It was a good effort. Good poke check at the line there. That's Jacob Lee for RPI, kicking it all the way down the ice. It'll be played by Brandon Less, former Dartmouth Big Green. Good interception there by Lepinen, but he couldn't corral it. Chow will chop it out to neutral. And then Jacob Lee shoots in for RPI. We got a couple of former teammates playing against each other in Shane Seller and Brandon Less. Brendan Less, excuse me. Laka tried to keep it in along the boards all in one motion, and he fanned on it, but RPI will shoot it in again. Chorney lifting it far side to the point. Kept in by Agnew momentarily. Now good hustle by Lepinen back in his own zone. Shoots it off the wall. It'll be Laka turning and firing it ahead for Dubinsky. Dubinsky into the circle on his backhand. A shot and a save. Rebound gloved away. It will be a hand pass, but could have been worse for the Bobcats there. As good bit of play through the neutral zone for RPI turns into a chance for Dubinsky.
Yeah, good play by the Quinnipiac defenseman to corral that puck and just bat it out of the air.
Better to be safe than sorry there.
Yeah, I don't think that the goaltender Peretz knew where it was after he made the initial save.
He had kind of spun around. Face-off win for RPI. Hallbauer at the point, settles it down and sends it across to Surdy. Lauri Surdy thinking about a shot, now works it deep. RPI player ends up on top of one of the Bobcats there. Now a good strip by Linden, sending it in front for Lee, and he just couldn't get his stick on it. It'll be lobbed back out to center ice. Surdy on it there. Bobcats making a partial change as Lauri Surdy moves into the zone. Mendel wraps it around, comes free to the point. Hallbauer a shot through traffic, and getting too much of that one was Linden. He was trying to tip it on goal, but he almost stopped the shot altogether. And now Metsa lifting it around. Waiting for it is Filion, the freshman from Sherbrooke, Quebec. Gets it as far as the neutral zone where RPI takes over. Engineers doing a good job defending, Coach, in the attacking zone and the neutral zone right now.
Yeah, they're doing a real good job. I just was watching the changes for RPI. Looks like they got mixed up a little bit as Adamo had jumped on for Jacob Lee. Jacob Lee's playing the right side. Adamo's playing the middle.
Trying to jam it in front for Adamo. He just couldn't get his stick on as it was poked away. Good play by McIsaac there, who picked up an assist and on Jack Brackett's goal on Sunday. RPI fans want a hold or something there along the side of the net. Not going to get it. McIsaac just battling for it in the corner. And he'll spin it down low. Knocked out of the air by Schreifels. Kind of sat on the dasher for a moment, but now it's down in the corner, right in front of the Zamboni door. Now we get, I think, a puck played with a high stick.
Yep.
4:14 to go in the first. Shots are 8-6 Bobcats. They lead 1-0 on a goal by Michael Lombardi.
RPI's fourth line is doing a good job. You look for that line to go out there and create some energy, and then you hope that the other lines will follow suit. Real good shift by Adamo, and as you mentioned, McIsaac.
RPI getting it in. Lee will wrap it to the side for Chow. And now Oliver Chow, grad student from Oakville, Ontario, to the near side and all the way down. They wave off the icing, says Adam Wood. Jack Agnew. Johnson trying to flip it ahead. He had Brackett breaking. It was a good idea. It was just intercepted by Quinnipiac, and now Agnew. Just touching up there neatly was Van Ness. Get his feet behind the line and keep the play alive for Quinnipiac. Now Chow back to the point on his backhand. It's Less. He'll flip it around. Van Ness again. Van Ness gets free, trying to wrap it home. Loose at the other side of the net. Now it's slapped back to the point for Lee. DDD pass. Shot blocked by Gagno out of play. We get a stoppage here. 3:14 left in the period. Both teams have had a power play chance in this frame. Neither successful so far. Another look at the play on the wraparound.
That just hit somebody's skate over there. You can't really tell where it went, but that side of the net was wide open and Marshall had committed to the puck carrier coming from behind the net.
Draw here in the RPI zone. Played by Hallbauer and now Lepinen. Dubinsky will move in. Takes a shot, hit a shin pad, lapping it. Hallbauer, wrist shot, that's blocked as well by Lombardi. And the Bobcats had thoughts of moving out quickly, but that was slowed up by the engineer's forecheck, and now they go backwards with it. Now an awkward play behind the goal. Chorney gives it away. Laka with Dubinsky skating away from his man. Back to the point, it was deflected off a skate, and Hallbauer have to go back to his own zone to get it.
I don't know what Jorney was thinking of with that puck behind the Quinnipiac net.
Looks like he almost stepped on it. Hallbauer will shoot it in. Waiting for it is Metsa. He'll go up the wall with it. Good play by Linden to break it up. Turned back around by Friedman. DeYoung trying to pick up speed into the zone. Pulls up at the near side of the net. Flipping it back to the line. Good keep there. But Fanning on it was Rassinen. Seller was breaking. They couldn't quite find him. And now RPI will reset and try to maintain possession of the puck here. Seller ahead, poking it off of Rassinen. Almost runs into Linden there, but now they sort things out. Indirect back to the point is a good one for Klee. Shot blocked into the netting. And we get another stoppage in play as the engineers are looking to be, you know, looking to be pretty direct when they get the puck, especially sometimes at the point getting these shots. Some of them aren't getting through, but that time Klee just trying to get that quick snapshot off, maybe through a screen.
Yeah, I mean, Filion did a good job for Quinnipiac staying in the shooting lane, but that was the defenseman for RPI, Klee. You got to be able to move laterally across that blue line, hoping to pull that forward out of the shooting lane.
Face off here, puck goes behind the goal. Lee has it there for the Bobcats. He'll quickly move it up the wall. Smolanik getting it deep. He gets another chance at it now, but he kicks it further. Johnson off for Dubinsky. Back to Johnson. Jake Johnson taking a look up ice. Feeds a saucer pass to the far wing where Laka shoots it in. Minute 23 to go in the first period. hard off the wall and out to center. Laka, touch pass for Dubinsky. Nifty play there from Lapinen. Only just results in a dump in the end. Bongiovanni into the RPI zone. Runs into two engineers and trying to flip it back to the point, but his D-men were changing. Now Mendel in his own end. Back to Rassinen. We got three Finns in this game. Two for RPI, one for the Bobcats. Here's one of them now, Surti. Get some help from Schreifels. Adamo's just going to lob it into the corner with 30 seconds to go in the frame. McIsaac on the chase. Mendel quickly up the wall for Chow. Chow throws it off a stick. It's gloved at by Hallbauer. And RPI is going to be able to clear eventually. It's picked up by McIsaac, chipping off the boards for Brackett, trying to pick up speed. He's cut off by Lee with 13. And now Quinnipiac. Van Ness off the boards. Friedman into the circle, looking for a shooting lane. And since the early stages of this game, the RPI engineers have really shut down Quinnipiac offensively. They really haven't had anything going, Coach, since the goal. And I guess their power play, they had a couple of shots, but really, RPI clamping down in the second half of that first period.
Yeah, they're really skating with them. You know, Quinnipiac's a skating team. RPI is matching that, keeping up with them with their foot speed. The other thing RPI is doing a great job of is using the indirects in the neutral zone with forwards moving their feet with speed, attacking the offensive blue line, and basically being cutters, getting in behind the D and allowing them to penetrate the offensive blue line.
Shots are 8-6, Quinnipiac through one. They lead 1-0. We'll have more RPI hockey coming up on RPI TV and ESPN after just a bit. All right, just about set for the start of the second period. RPI and number four Quinnipiac from the Houston Fieldhouse. Want to welcome all the RPI hockey fans out there, wherever you're watching tonight's game. We do hope to see you in the Houston Fieldhouse again someday. I'm not sure when that day is, Coach, but...
I was wondering where you were going.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry if I got anyone's hopes up there, but...
Reminds me of a song by Steve Bishop.
I just want to see more fans in here, and I'm sure they'll come back if they're allowed, so...
I agree.
But the folks that are here, the RPI students, are being awful loud right behind the RPI bench here as we get set for the second period. An update from the women's game over in Hanover. They're halfway through the third period. RPI has taken a 2-1 lead. Congrats to Naya Phillip for scoring her first career goal, Coach.
Nice. That was great to get that first one out of the way.
And then Audrey McCutcheon also scored for the RPI women, who lead 2-1. Midway point of that third frame up there. It's a big game for RPI women. They need all 3 points if they can get them in their hopes for making it to the playoffs. Here we have a 1-0 Quinnipiac lead as Desi Burghardt goes into the end boards, and the Engineers come away with the puck, moving it to center ice. It's the defenseman Agnew chipping in. Behind for Laca. Laca trying to give it back to the point. It's intercepted by Filion. He'll play it ahead as Burghardt will chip deep, senior from North Vancouver, British Columbia. They have a few kids from North Vancouver. Puck back to center. It's shot back in. Actually too high and out of play. This will be a center ice draw when we restart. 51 seconds into period number two. Have to like the way the Engineers finished that first period, Coach.
Actually, they played a great first period. I mean, other than just, you know, one offensive rush.
Yeah.
And a great move by the winger Lombardi.
It's a little bit, bit reminiscent of the weekend where they played against a top 20 team, this being the number four team in the country, as Surdy is going to take a shot off the end boards. He was maybe looking for a tip from Lee that doesn't come. Lombardi into the skates of Bongiovanni. RPI is able to pick it up, and Sellers shoots it back in. Just have to find that finishing touch. And that's the difference. As now a chance to break. It's Smolanik, and Smolanik's pass goes all the way through. He elected to pass the puck instead of shoot it there. And now back come the Engineers as Lee taking a hit. Halbauer, the defenseman, moving his way in. He got as far as the slot before it's chopped away from him. You can see why Smolanik was picked to go play for the national team. He's got some quicks.
Yeah, I'm surprised he passed that too. He had Lombardi going to the net, but he was in prime real estate.
Nice move here. Sent across. As that was Baxter making a move up ice. Now an outlet pass to Van Ness into the zone, watched by Klee. Takes a shove from Mason Klee. And now Chow. Chow again, wrapped up by Baxter, lets him go. Behind the goal for Brindamore, trying to spin and fire, broken up by Gagneau. Long shot, blocker save by Marshall into the corner. One-hand whack from Baxter doesn't get it to work. Now Van Ness behind the goal. Gagneau trying to rough him up, but Van Ness turned towards the net front. It was knocked away from him, takes a funny hop off the glass, and now Gagneau has all the time in the world, and he'll just dump it in as the Engineers were at the end of a shift. And now shot back in the other way. Adamo waits for it at the half boards. High in the air in front of the bench. Gloved at by Mendel. And they're going to say hand pass here. I'm not sure it even touched another Bobcat, but referee's in a better position than me. That's Kenny, the referee, Anthony Kenny. 3 minutes gone here in the second. Just one shot in the period. It belongs to Quinnipiac, but more of the same from these two teams. Space hard to come by. Matty Papineau has given RPI a 3-1 lead with 6.5 to go up in Hanover. This will be wrapped around Johnson towards goal, looking for the deflection. Didn't get it from Laca, who was in good position there. There's a couple Engineers providing Bit of a disturbance in front of the Quinnipiac net. Now back to the point. One-timer by Agnew. And that one's knocked away by the pad of Peratz. Johnson behind the goal. He'll actually elect to play it up the boards for Laka. And now on for Dubinsky. Lapping it. Dubinsky in deep. He goes down in the corner. Puck comes free. And DeYoung will play. Ethan DeYoung gets as far as the red line. Now it's stripped away by Lapinen. What an effort there. Oh, it's taken right back by Mendel and shot to center. Ottaville playing with some tenacity tonight,
which is always good to see.
Off of Brackett, taken over by Lay, and now Ethan Lay goes cross-ice with it. Finding Cipollone. He has the only penalty for the Bobcats tonight. Adamo's going to shoot this in off of Chorney. Back to the point. Long shot. Surdy hits bodies in front. Four of them, two each way. Could have hit anybody on the way through. Now, nice job digging it out of some skates there by McIsaac. He'll send it back to the point where Surdy plays it back in deep. Adamo trying to step through a check. Nice job to work it back to the line for Hallbauer. Now Adamo gets it back and absorbs a hit. Puck's gone, and neither player realizes it. He and Friedman were digging away at air, as it'll be played by Cipollone.
Jack Brackett went to the bench, kind of gingerly. Looked like he got hit along the wall.
Engineers can't afford to lose too many more forwards here. Let's just say it's a good thing they have 31 guys. 30 guys, excuse me. They're getting good play from some of the guys that haven't had a lot of experience so far, whether it be Brackett or McIsaac, who had a good connection in the game on Sunday. Jacob Lee is playing on the wing tonight, but he's done well when he's had to play center for RPI, about a 50% faceoff man. Maybe a little over that. This will leave the zone. Past Rassinen. And now Smolanic shot. That's blocked. Second try. Tried to feed it in front for Lombardi, but the engineers cover up the front of the net well.
Yeah, good defensive play to put that puck to the side.
Stretch pass here. Linden lets it run through his own legs. Now fires it back into the far corner. Seller right back down low. Lee, Linden. Snapping it back towards Seller, and the bouncing puck's played back to the point. Mason Klee, a shot, and that one didn't go wide by much. Linden into the slot for Seller, who shields the puck away from Metsa. And be gloved at by Lee, but he didn't get there. Goes right to Linden. Now Mason Klee steps into one, and that one skips just wide. Mason Klee making a bid for his first goal of the year there a couple of times.
Good pressure here by RPI.
Lifted up the boards and all the way down. Anthony Baxter has a step on Lombardi. And he'll use the net as a screen to escape. 6:10 gone in the second. And we get a whistle and an icing call.
Yeah, unfortunately, that pass just skipped over Lee's stick for an icing. Good play by Baxter on the breakout. Using that net as a way to separate himself from the forechecker.
Face off here. Sent to the point. Off a skate. Goes behind the RPI goal. Van Ness through Mendel's stick and out to center. He takes a hard hit from Lee, but does get the puck in. Lyndon Marshall, grad student from Victoria, British Columbia. And now a shot goes wide. And now off the boards, or off the glass, rather, Marshall just gloves it there right in front of Brindamore.
Yeah, he wasn't going to take any chances with that thing getting away on him. He had a couple of Quinnipiac guys right on his doorstep.
Skyler Brindamore, of course, the son of Rod Brindamore, longtime NHLer, now the head coach of the Carolina Hurricanes. Sure he had to deal with Ken Klee in his career. One of RPI's NHL legacies, Simon Kjellberg, is not in the lineup tonight. Hope he's okay. Of course, he's the son of Patrick Kjellberg. Now a jam try in front. That was Burghardt.
Yeah, he just shot that wide.
Yeah, and a nice job by Bowman to beat out the icing. Gagneau strips it away. Bowman's going to ring it around. Agnew has to skate all the way across the ice to play. I think he had just come off the bench. And now finding it was beaten, knocked away from him. Gagneau again, reaching for it was Agnew. And now DeJong up the boards, but right to Johnson. He'll throw it quickly ahead, although had a lot of air under that pass, and Bowman had to wait for it and allowed the Bobcats to get back into position defensively.
If he had to put that pass up a little harder, you had two Quinnipiac players trapped coming from the bench.
Yeah, when he released it, I thought it was going to get there pretty quick, but Johnson threw it high in the air to make sure it got there. Leppinen hard off the boards on the backhand. They wave off the icing, so Mendel has to play. 12 minutes to go in the second. 1-0 Quinnipiac still. Lay ahead, knocked out of the air, but not controlled by Boshin. And now Leppinen feeding it in deep again. The engineers have done a good job tonight when they've wanted to get the puck in deep. They've done it. Snap pass in front. Leppinen, a shot to save. Rebound, another stop. Another one off the post. Still scrapping away. And they're jamming, and the netminder is out of the net, and somehow that doesn't go. Hallbauer a shot, and that one will leave the ice sheet and go up into the netting. I don't know how the engineers didn't score there.
Neither do I. He must have a necklace of clovers around his neck, four-leaf clovers.
That one hit the post for sure.
Yeah,
that was
hit the
Dubinsky
post. And then he's just laying there hoping that it's going to be underneath him at some point, but it never got there.
Who was the defenseman playing goalie? Was it Mendel?
Yes.
Yeah. Look at that. Was Lay.
Yeah, Griffin Mendel was there too.
Mendel and Ethan Lay. Lay had his knee down playing goalie. There's a shot by Schreifels just wide. Dubinsky ends up hitting the post after Leppinen has two shots stopped by Peretz. That's how you have a one-and-change goal against average, Coach.
Definitely.
Because you put a force field in front of your net. Even when you're not there, it doesn't matter. Linden has it hit a skate. Now back the other way. Shot comes in. Oh, Marshall with a save. A huge one right there as he denies Smolanic.
Well, if you ever want a guy with the puck on a breakaway, Smolanic's the guy.
Yeah,
there he
goodness.
Comes right here. Not really a breakaway, but
right. Surdy did. Surdy got back into position. Credit him.
He had to take it from the angle. He really couldn't get back to the middle. Although he's somewhat in the middle right now.
And Marshall would surely prefer that the player shoots than try to dangle him.
Yes.
Marshall's very good at least making that first save. That time he was great in making the save and not allowing a rebound.
He's played real well when the RPIs needed him.
Yeah. Could have been a costly giveaway, but the engineers and Lyndon Marshall are still just down by one. Remember that save. RPI is able to creep back into this one. Now here's some space for Brindamore. He'll flip it deep and chase. Trying to play it around behind. Johnson has it. At the line, Adamo. Nice keep in there by Rassinen. Chow. Van Ness. Shoved by Adamo. Quickly back to his feet, though. And back to the point. Nice play there by Van Ness. A drive and a glove save by Marshall as he just got a piece of that shot from Rassinen. Second period, halfway gone. Bobcats on the attack. Brindamore a shot. That takes a deflection off of Chow. Johnson was in good position. Rassinen across the line. Metsa. Take a shot blocked by Brackett, and he'll move it out to center. We had a whistle here, and they're going to blow a dent for offside. 9:39 on the clock. 1-0 Bobcats still, thanks to a first period goal from Michael Lombardi at 7:28.
We've had good offensive action around both nets. Of course, the post has been up for the challenge for Peretz and Marshall making
couple of real good saves in his zone as well.
Over RPI women's hockey defeating Dartmouth 3-1. Nia Phillip, Audrey McCutcheon, and Maddie Papineau with goals for the Engineers. Big win for the RPI women. Their
huge
third in league play. 3 points. In the new point system in the league. Sent back to the blue line. Good find. Here's Johnson. He'll drop it off. Baxter, a long shot. That one hit his own man, Seller. And now again, off to the races, it's Smolanic. But Johnson, another good defensive play. Jake Johnson's having quite a season here as a senior. Both ends of the ice. Flip deep by Seller. Lee's there. Sturdy pinching. Knocked away from him. DeYoung to center, 2-on-2. With Filion. DeYoung trying to drop it off for Filion, but Sturdy gets to it first. He overskates, though. Behind the goal, it's Burghardt. He tried a little wraparound play. That didn't work. Now he gets it back again. A quick shot and a save by Marshall. As Burghardt found himself in a good spot. Now a slap shot is a wild one from Filion. That'll leave the zone.
I think that went off the post, Perry.
Which one?
The one that you... That last shot.
That last one hit the post?
Yeah, I think I heard it.
We'll have to agree to disagree on that one, Coach. Well, we rarely do that.
I know.
You might be right, but it came out of the zone pretty quick. Maybe I need to check my hearing.
I thought.
You could be right. I just saw it as being...
It looked like it hit his blocker, but...
Okay. Oh, the previous shot,
yes.
You're talking about. Okay, yeah, that one. Not the wild one that left the zone.
Oh, no.
The chance that Burghardt had. Okay, yes, definitely. It could have certainly hit the post.
Yes.
After it caught the stick of Marshall. It was very close. Yeah, I agree with you on that. Okay. We're back on the same page.
Yep.
Anyway, this is shot back to center ice. Johnson... Now in his own zone, will play it up the wall. Laka, kept alive by Lay. Johnson takes a couple of looks. He'll chip it up the boards for Dubinsky. Another NHL legacy is Zach Dubinsky. Broken up behind the goal. Loose in the slot. Whacking at it was Lepinen, just enough to disrupt the play as Friedman was trying to find it. DeYoung goes through him, and now Lepinen will play. 7 minutes to go here in the second. High in the air and all the way down. This will be icing on RPI if it gets there. And it goes rolling down, and it'll draw a whistle.
Wow. That thing slowed down enough, I thought it was going to be waved off.
Yeah.
I think Dave Smith thought the same thing.
Well, no dice. Face-off back in the RPI zone. Draws right now pretty tight, 14-13 RPI. Talking about hustle stats, the Bobcats have blocked 11 shots. RPI has blocked 4. That's also how you help your goalie out. This is flipped into the zone. Two or three Bobcats still need a touch up, and they allows RPI to clear on the carry. That's Johnson shooting it in. Peretz waits for it. Plays up the boards. Gagno chipping back to the point. Nice gather there. And a shot comes in, and it skips off the, maybe the base of the net near the left post. Nice little drag there by Adamo, but he kind of gives it away now to Brindamore.
From his knees, no less.
Yeah, he'll surprise you with his hands every once in a while. You don't expect a guy 6'6", 250 to make a play like that. Just along the line, and they say Klee didn't keep that in.
That was a far official linesman that made that call. Let's see here. Oh, no.
No, I'm sorry.
That's why this guy didn't call it, and the other guy did.
To be fair to the near linesman, Klee's stick was kind of covering up the puck. But at the same time, I don't think he left his own. That's okay. If that's the biggest mistake of the game by our officials, then we had a pretty good game. Seller's going to ring this one in. They don't have the benefit of RPI TV, Coach. Long shot in. Blocker save by Peretz. And now Lombardi on the carry to center ice. 2-on-2. Dragging his back toe there was TJ Friedman. Stay onside. Now he'll pin the puck up in the corner with Surdy. Shots are 13-11. Quinnipiac with 5:35 to go in the second period. Oops, a couple guys went down in the corner there. Lee was one of them. Bobcat player still down. He's holding his head. That's, I think, a Bon Giovanni. Oh, yeah, it is.
Well, Lee had his stick caught underneath his chin.
Well, that'll do it.
And he pulled and pulled on his stick and almost took his chin off.
Hopefully Bon Giovanni's all right. He's on the bench now getting looked at. That's good eyes again by you. I didn't see what was going on over there, but they both kind of went down in a heap. Bobcat's on the attack.
Well, he pulled two or three times.
Yeah. I missed that. I was trying to find the puck. That's why Fridge is here.
That's why I'm on color.
Yeah, right. He's looking for the scraps. the dust-ups.
Yeah.
Baxter. DeYoung. Nice job to spin away from Bowman. Now give it back. Nice play by Marshall to stick with the play. As it almost developed too quickly, DeYoung went behind the goal, tried to pass it back, but Marshall hadn't left the post. Now here's Bowman walking in. Bowman, a shot and a save. Rebound! And it was Schreifel's crashing the net. He never got a stick on it. But a good effort there again by the engineers. Nick Bowman has a great shot and was able to show it off there. Beaten. Off for Schreifel's. Top of the circle. He'll pull one back and take a shot that's blocked. And now the defenseman will start the rush the other way. It's Metsa with Chow. Chow to the net. Loose in front. And Van Ness couldn't do much with it except for tap it into the corner and chase it down.
That last opportunity by RPI, it looks like that was offside. That was close.
They finally get it out of the corner. Mendel throws it right back where it came from. Chow behind the goal. He gets pinned up there momentarily by Laka. And they got to be careful. That's going to be a penalty on Laka.
Yeah, that's hooking all day long.
Now a pass across the net front. RPI gets a touch. And the Bobcats will go on their second power play of the game. Laka was okay for a little while. And then right there, he gets a hold of the stick, and that's going to be a penalty.
Yeah, I think it's going to be interference. More than a hook.
I thought hold, but interference works. I didn't actually see what they called.
I haven't seen it yet either.
Interference, you got it, Coach. Quinnipiac 0-for-1 on the power play. They had a chance back in the first period. So a big power play here late in the second period in a game that seems to be decided by probably one goal by the time we're done here. Every little play counts. We've seen some big saves in this period. Now Surdy trying to clear off the glass. Is gloved down by, and we got a penalty the other way. And Lee got in the way of Lappinen. You can credit Otto Ville Lappinen for drawing that penalty with his hustle. We've seen him hustling all night, and that time it turns into something good for RPI.
There's another look at it. Puck gets by him, and he's thinking, Lepinen's going to be off to the races, and I'm going to, well, he kind of sold that too.
That's okay.
Yep, definitely.
So Lee kind of compounded the issue of not gloving the puck by then getting in the way of Lepinen.
You're better to back off the line in that situation, because even if you do keep it in, you're going to get run over by Lepinen.
Good hit there by Agnew, as Burkhardt was not looking for that. And he's slow to the bench. So 4-on-4 for another minute before RPI has an abbreviated power play. Here's Lee into the zone. Drops it back. Linden looking for a lane, and Metsä just got his stick in the way. As Tuur Linden takes another look at that, saying,
See, that's why you want to let that puck go right away.
Yeah, he's going to look at it.
Because all he does, when he makes that move right there, that little stick handle, that gives the defense an opportunity to get a stick on it.
54 seconds away from an RPI power play.
I think Grant Pecknold was questioning that hit.
Looked clean from here. He definitely kept his elbow down, which is what I was looking for.
Yeah, he got his shoulder in.
Jack Agnew with a nice hit there. So a couple of Bobcats have been shaken up in this period. Bongiovanni and Burkhardt, two of the top two line centers.
Well, that's how you play a team that likes to skate, skate, skate. You put the body on them, slow them down.
RPI breaking to center. It's Brackett. A goal and an assist so far this season for Jack Brackett. Sophomore from Manassas, Virginia. Through six games. This is his seventh game as an engineer, although he is a sophomore. Of course, the engineer's not competing last year. Unlike the Bobcats, they were one of the four ECAC hockey teams to play last year.
Yeah, they lost an ECAC championship.
They lost to St. Lawrence.
Home.
Yeah, to St. Lawrence. And it turned out to be the engineers, or the ECAC, didn't send anybody to the tournament because St. Lawrence had a COVID, what do you call it, outbreak. I guess there's no better word for it, but they didn't go to the tournament. The NCAA, that is. So RPI's power play off to a bit of a slow start as Johnson's pass hits a skate. 17 to go on. It's a very short one. It was only about 50 seconds to begin with. Under a minute to go here as it's knocked out of the air nicely by Metsä, not once but twice.
Yeah, double.
As the power play is about to be over. We are back to 5-on-5. 46 seconds to go in the second period. 1-0 Bobcats. Brendan Lass will tap it around. Lombardi. High in the air out to center. Now a race for it as Lee's going to go off on a change. Hallbauer will play behind the goal. Trying to get away from Bongiovanni. Good to see him back out there for Quinnipiac. Shot in deep. Adamo's going to chase. Mendel. Bowman for RPI has it pinned against the boards. 14 seconds to go in the period. Puck comes free behind the goal. Lappinen throws a hit, trying to get away from Bongiovanni. Throws it in front, but it's intercepted nicely by Mendel. And now we get a penalty here. And it's going to be interference. And now both number 11s having a word with each other, Lappinen and Bongiovanni. It's going to be a penalty, I think, on Quinnipiac here.
Yeah, but Bongiovanni's going to go for interference.
He took down Lappinen.
He's pesky.
Lappinen was just trying to get to the puck, and Bongiovanni didn't let him get there. And now he's... I don't know if he was chirping the RPI bench or not, but he definitely gave a couple of looks over there. I don't think the engineers were paying attention.
Well, 2.2 seconds. Rule of thumb is if it's under three, you can't get it the length of the ice for a goal. So
okay.
Coach Smith is going to pull his goaltender for a 6-on-4, 2.2 second faceoff. And Linden, being a right shot, is probably going to go to the net with it.
And the puck goes into the corner, and it becomes a moot point, but a late penalty here on Bongiovanni, who I'm sure wasn't too happy for when he got shook up a few minutes earlier in the corner, remember, with Lee. He finally gets back out on the ice, and he takes the penalty, an ill-advised one, with the Bobcats in possession of the puck and really running out the clock in the period. So the Bobcats will have a one-goal lead as we go to the third, but the Engineers will have almost 2 full minutes of power play time when we do. We will step aside. You are watching RPI Hockey on RPI TV and ESPN. Third period of action about to get going here. Coach, what do we got?
Tell you what, should be a barn burner here. RPI's got to get some offense going, take advantage of the fresh ice out here to start the third period on the power play. Just looking up some scores and other ECAC action right now. Start of period number three, Clarks is up 2-1 on Colgate. St. Lawrence and Cornell are tied one apiece in the third period. Nothing over at Union College between Princeton Tigers and the Dutchman. And it's 0-0 starting the third period between Harvard and Brown. And of course the RPI women picking up a big win today at Dartmouth, 3-1.
20 minutes on the clock. I know former Dartmouth SID Pat Salvis is watching this one intently with his Tuber's former players in action here. I am envious of him as he's sitting on the couch watching hockey instead of having to put on real clothes and go to a hockey rink, but that's okay.
He's not getting a real feel for it.
he's got a sweet backyard rink. There's a quick shot that goes wide for his two little ones to play on. I am envious of that for sure, not just the free time. Anyway, we got a good one going here.
He's almost Canadian then.
Yeah, up in Hanover there.
Yep.
Hallbauer trying to keep it alive and does. It'll be shot past him and all the way down. They wave off the icing here. I've seen some pics of folks getting their boards ready for their backyard rinks. Now they just need some cold weather, which we kind of have right now. It's not quite cold enough, but we're dipping down below 32 degrees, which is what you need.
I used to have one back in the day.
Yeah?
Yes.
Never invited me over.
Right on the side of the...
Right on the side of the house?
Yeah. I don't think we knew each other then.
No, we didn't. I'd say you could flood the... Flood some of your yard there, I'm sure.
That's where I learned how to skate on outdoor rink.
Me too, but I'm from Minnesota, so that's a given. If folks didn't know that already. Minute and a half into this third period. 22 seconds to go on this RPI power play. Pass for Johnson to leave the zone.
If you didn't know that already.
You probably haven't been watching too many hockey games here at RPI.
No, just go to the YouTube RPI TV.org and watch the St. Cloud series.
I was going to say, you can watch any game. I almost guarantee he'll bring it up. Out of the box. Back to even is Quinnipiac, so they escaped that as Bongiovanni took that late second period penalty. RPI got the puck in the zone, didn't quite get a good look at goal from there. Now Chorney, or excuse me, yeah, this is Marcus Chorney. Here's a Hastings, Minnesota guy. We knew it fit it in. Good play by Brackett to close down his man. That was Lombardi at the wall. Now McIsaac's facing the wrong way, but he hands it off to Brackett. Tapped away from him. Now Lombardi up the wall. Semlanek lost it. Hallbauer. Outlet pass here. Brackett into the zone. Kicks it into the corner where he deals with Less. Surdy. Brackett. Towards the net, sticked away by Peretz. And he'll come to the side of the net, and Peretz will put his mitt on him. He's got a pretty shiny goalie mask. I don't think we've talked about it yet, Coach. Peretz there. You can see it there on the screen. Got some glint to it. Looks like some gleam. It looks like someone that Notre Dame would wear.
Well, you know what's funny? Right before the game, I texted Coach Pecknold, and I said, it looks like your goaltender bought his mask from Jeff Jackson, who, of course, is the head coach at Notre Dame. Hit the nail on the head.
Even funnier is that their other goalie, Dylan St. Cyr, used to go to Notre Dame, and he doesn't have a shiny helmet.
Wow, that is interesting.
Well, in fact, when they were coming out of the locker room, I thought that was St. Cyr just wearing his same gold mask. But right. No, it was Peretz, who was a former Penticton V.
Well, the one thing about the masks that Notre Dame wears
outside
of the iTech, they wear gray-colored cages, and I can never figure that out because the ideal cage to wear is black.
Yeah.
The eye does not pick up black as a color, whereas it does pick up gray, and I've never understood that.
Brindamore playing it back to the line. Now here's Schreifels on for Seller. Has it knocked away. Back come the Bobcats. Chow into the zone. Tries to one-hand it around behind. Bouncing puck played by Agnew. Right into the path of Van Ness. Skylar Brindamore hops past him. Seller past Schreifels. One linesman down here. Taylor Larson looked like he almost waved off the icing, but on better thought, they do blow it dead. I don't think anyone touched it. 15:54 to go third period. Still 1-0 Quinnipiac. And there's a
hand pass.
Okay, I was going to say.
Yep. He knocked it down.
And yeah.
He knocked it down right here, then gets knocked over.
Yep. No, you're right. I did the gesture by the referee on the far side. I didn't recognize. Looked like he was shooting a basketball hoop, but he's doing that. I didn't know that was hand pass. Usually it's the underhand motion. Anyway, puck to the side of the Quinnipiac net, but Beaton couldn't find it. Now it's gloved down at center by Johnson. Nice job by him to spin it around, but then he gives it away. A little toe drag there. Doesn't work for Cipollone.
He gets it back.
It's played in deep. On the chase is Gagneau. Cipollone takes a look. Feeds it ahead for Lee. Baxter intercepts as he jumped the play. It's turned back around by Quinnipiac. Kind of a busted play into the zone. Almost a 3-on-3, but taken back quickly by Gagneau, and he'll spin it down low for his defensive teammate, Mason Klee.
That was a good back check and defensive play by him. It was almost a 3-on-1 there for Quinnipiac.
Yeah, some of these RPI players who did not see ice time early in the year, of course, getting that time, and when you get that opportunity, you got to take advantage of it, and that means skating hard all the time. As that shot in and was headed wide anyway, it's going to be gloved by Peretz, and he'll hold on for a whistle.
Hey, here's another look at it.
One of stick goes flying away.
Yeah, he lifted the stick. He used to have a player, Wayne Clark.
Yeah.
We'd be on the bench, I'd be coaching, and out of nowhere, this stick would go flying through the air, and I'm thinking, okay, Clarky's on the ice, sure enough. Of course, you could get an interference penalty for doing that.
True.
He was pretty sly, though.
Flipped in there by Burghardt. Good to see him back out there. He took a pretty nasty hit from Jack Agnew in the second period. Dragging it ahead there. Nice move. A couple of them from Kyle Halbauer, and the whistle goes for offside, and RPI was in business if not for that whistle.
Well, that was Adamo that stepped over, and that was because he went from the backhand to the forehand along the blue line, which kind of put Adamo offside. You got to get that puck across the blue line before you start stick handling.
RPI's had some good offensive D-men in their history. I'm sure a number of them played for you. But Kyle Halbauer can stick handle with the best of them.
No question.
Some are better passers, distributors from the blue line, but Kyle can really just handle the puck. We saw it there as he nearly set up a grade A chance for the Engineers. Here's Lappinen back to the line. Halbauer making a move. Spinning with it. Trying to send it back to the line for Lappinen, who had taken his spot. And he just couldn't control it. He'll end up dumping it in. Shots are 15 apiece. Lappinen broke that up, but Bongiovanni carries in. Try to pull it back there was Smolanic, and that's broken up again. Rassinen. And now Metsa.
Whoa.
And that's going to be icing.
I can't believe that wasn't called a high stick. Metsa took that right in the face mask.
There has never been a 1-0 game in this series in its history, either way.
Well, out of the 14 games that Quinnipiac has played to date, 10 of them they've allowed less than 20 shots on goal.
RPI is approaching that mark. They're 5 away. It's 15-15 right now. But the engineers do a good job in that department, too. If you looked at those stats, you'd say this is going to be 1-0, 2-1. I mean, you don't necessarily predict a 1-0 game in college hockey, but not out of the question when these two teams got together before even this one started. There's a long shot saved by Marshall. He pops up or coughs up a rebound, but there's no one around because the engineers did a good job of sealing things off, and Van Ness doesn't like the way he was dealt with, and has a couple of things to say to Jacob Lee, and Jacob Lee has a couple of things to say to him. 12:39 to go, third period.
See, it's okay right here, but then Baxter gives them this one.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, and the referee's looking right at it.
Yeah.
I mean.
It wasn't Lee. Lee was playing peacemaker there, but,
no, but
the damage had been done.
If you want a game to get out of hand, you let stuff like that go, and then you're trying to manage it.
Can't do that. I'm surprised, you're right, that nothing was called there. There is that bit of grace period in front of the net where defenders are allowed to do a few more things, but that was a little over the line. Back to the point for Johnson. Jake Johnson, little shimmy, plays it right back down low. Bowman. Trying to pin it up. He's met by a pair of Bobcats, and Quinnipiac moves it to center. Friedman. Touched on by Cipollone. Wrapped towards the point, but kept in momentarily by Filion. Pass Bowman, and this is going to be icing on the engineers. Princeton comes to town tomorrow night. Take on these engineers. The Bobcats head over to Schenectady to take on Union, who's playing some good hockey recently. Agnew has his man tied up in the corner, but the puck pops free to DeYoung. Stripped away from him, and now Gagneau shooting it in. Marcus Chorney, former Amarillo Bull, plays it to center ice and gets it back. Actually, this is going to be shot in by Less. And now McIsaac, it squeaks through him, but right to Adamo, who shields the puck along and plays it in deep with one hand. Good pressure here by the engineers, forcing the turnover. McIsaac, he takes a hit and loses it. Off the skate of Adamo, gloved down by McIsaac. James McIsaac cycling for Adamo, past him. Burghardt to center ice. Halbauer's there. DeYoung gets shoved into the zone. Four of his teammates change behind him, and the engineers will take over there. Surdy with some pressure. Indirect off the boards just to alleviate that pressure. Now, shot out of play by Metsa, and a neutralized faceoff upcoming. 10:52 to go as the Bobcats try to put a stranglehold on their 11th win. RPI trying to generate offense from somewhere. Where are they going to get it from at this point, Coach?
I just think they keep doing what they're doing right now. I mean, both teams are playing really, really tight defensively.
Good poke check there. Laka has some time to look up ice. Just throws it off the skate of Metsa in the end. Lepinen trying to chase him down. Good play by Laka. Break things up with a skate, but Metsa has it again. He'll skate it ahead, finding Chow. Chopped at by Johnson. He'll get another chance at it. Laka takes a look. Fanned on the pass. Gets it as far as center where Mendel shoots it back in, and now Marshall will play behind the goal.
And the reason why both teams are not getting very many scoring chances because both teams are playing real well and not really making any mistakes. I think the opportunity that RPI gets, they're going to have to execute and capitalize on.
With this much time left, you have to think you're going to get at least one more opportunity, although they have been few and far to come by at both ends, as you mentioned. Hallbauer stick handling through center, lost it there. Friedman trying to turn it around, but Lee does a good job to get back in the way of that. Seller trying to hand it off for Hallbauer, give it away in front, shot comes in, they put it wide. Huge chance there. Off the mark from Ethan Lay.
Now if that's the other way with Quinnipiac making that mistake,
yeah,
that's what I'm talking about. You got to capitalize on that one. RPI dodged a bullet there.
I'm sure they weren't just doing it to make an example for you, but that's what happened.
Oh, no, they heard me.
Well, a couple times in the second period, it was Marshall making saves after the Engineers gave the puck away. That time, I think Lay just missed the net. Now Surdy a shot looking for a redirect. Seller a chance, and he tried to tap it on for Lee. Jacob Lee. Knocked down by Filion. Now Seller in the circle. Had it stripped away, but does enough to keep it in the zone on the cycle.
Boy, Seller had Tuur Linden on the back door there for a split second. And ended up getting checked.
Yeah, maybe the decision-making has to come just a little bit quicker for RPI right now.
Well, that's when those plays happen. When you transition from defense to offense, you have to make that pass right off the bat, quick and hard.
Diving attempt there from Bowman trying to play it ahead. And now losing an edge and going down was Filion. Baxter down the middle, tipped into the zone. Bowman with Schreifels chasing. Henri Schreifels throws a hit into Less. And now Lombardi takes a hit. Now trying to split the D is Smolonic. Gets the puck through, but not himself. And now he'll track it down in the corner. Rifles wrapped up there. Puck comes loose to Lombardi. 8 minutes to go. There's a pile up along the wall. Smolonic trying to center. Baxter defends the net front. And Schreifels will backhand it down the ice. Kind of hit an edge and stop moving, forcing Chorney to play, and he does up the wall. Bongiovanni into the zone. Try to make a move around Baxter. That's broken up. He elects to just play it deep as the Bobcats change. Stretch pass here, tipped deep by Leppinen. Peretz leaves it aside. We're seeing a lot of Zach Metza, senior from Deerfield, Wisconsin. Outlet to Chow. Tight angle, doesn't elect to shoot this. Back to the high slot area, some room for Metza. He'll take a shot, and Marshall makes the save. No rebound.
Yeah, Metza's eighth in points nationally and fifth in assists and third with plus minus with compared to other defensemen in the nation.
12 assists, 14 points for Metza. You want him out there at the end of the game, of course. Final media stoppage of the game here. With the shots sitting at 17-16 Quinnipiac. Faceoffs are 23-21 Bobcats. And the power play opportunities, there have been three of them for RPI, two for Quinnipiac, and no one has scored, of course, on the power play. The only goal was scored at 7:28 of the first period by Michael Lombardi, unassisted.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was speaking to Coach Pecknold before the game, and he said, you know, I read about how everyone thinks we're a real good defensive team, but actually what we try to do is just possess the puck all the time.
Yeah.
And reminds me of a conversation I had with the former coach of University of Minnesota, Don Lucia. I had called him one time and I said, hey, what kind of drills do you do to practice defensive zone coverage, defense? He said, we don't practice defense. I said, what? He goes, no, we practice offense. So when you think about it, if you're practicing offense, that means somebody's playing defense. And he said something very interesting. He goes, you know, whether somebody wants to play defense or not is an attitude. And he's right.
No, I can definitely see that. I would work on a few things in case the other team eventually gets the puck.
Yeah.
But I know I get what he's getting at.
because you see sometimes in hockey a line will go out there, they spend all the time in their defensive zone. They don't possess the puck, and then they get it over the red line, shoot it in, and that's their shift, all playing defense.
Whistle, and we'll do this again.
Yeah, Larson didn't drop it. I think Brindamore knocked it out of his hands. Interesting, Brindamore's wearing 22 and not 17.
True. He didn't go to a red and white school either. He went to a blue one. Here is Surdy down the middle off of Dubinsky, but he was on his own side of the red line. This is going to be icing. Are we going to see RPI take some more chances? Of course, we're going to see Marshall come out at some point, but the D-men going to jump up? We've seen that from really all games. Surdy and Hullbauer haven't really slowed up in their idea of trying to get into the attack.
Yeah, I don't think that ever changes until it's real late and you're up by a goal where the coach will just say, hey, you know what, defense, be very careful about activating.
Yeah.
I think they have to remain activated at this point.
Right. Off the base of the net, maybe caught the right pad of Marshall there, and a tight angle shot by DeYoung. Dubinsky up the boards. Lappinen gets a touch to it, but not enough to steer it away from Rassinen. Good play at the line. They're going to get a slash here, I think, on Dubinsky.
Either that or a trip.
Yeah. This is an important part of the game here, and now the Bobcats are going to play a little keep away with a delayed penalty. It was just Burghardt trying to enter the zone, and he got chopped down by Dubinsky. It's going to be a trip. And so now the most important kill of this one comes with 6:01 to go.
And this is where, you know, there's this false sense of security.
Yeah.
On Quinnipiac's part, thinking that they're on the power play.
Mm-hmm.
RPI could certainly take advantage of this, outwork them, and score a shorthanded goal.
Yeah. Otto Ville-Leppinen has RPI's lone shorty on the season. Came early on, him against Canisius, second weekend of the year. As Metsä keeping it in at the line. Bon Giovanni trying to send it across, but Chow just couldn't handle that. Had a little bit too much zip on it. Here's Metsä again. Chow down low. DeYoung gives it back to him. DeYoung up to Chow. All five guys on the ice here. Highly skilled for Quinnipiac. Bon Giovanni gets it back. Didn't like the shot. Back up to Metsä. Off for Chow. Chow a shot blocked by Johnson. Engineers can't clear it out yet. Baxter getting a stick to it. Bon Giovanni. Lee. It's stuck in the skates of Bon Giovanni now. No, RPI trying to jam it out. Linden gets the job done. Bobcats deliberate here in their breakout with 50 seconds to go on the power play. Sending it back to Lee. Now Lombardi has the lone goal. Off for Filion. Back to the point. Second unit out there. Van Ness. Bochin. Nick Bochin spinning. Bowman nearly took it away from him. Bochin now towards the middle of the ice. He's tied up by Bowman, but stays on the puck. Off for Lee. Loose puck. Hullbauer takes a look. Lifts it high down the ice. He thought about slapping it up the wall, but thought better of it and made the sure play down the middle in the air.
Yeah, smart play, because usually they close the wall off and nobody would be. That was a nice wrist shot as well.
Hullbauer all the way down, but quickly back into the zone comes Quinnipiac. 7 to go on the power play. Pops out to Lombardi. Back to the point for Lee. Lee, power play over. Dubinsky back, puck in the middle of the ice, and the engineers move it out on a pass. It's ahead for Dubinsky. Dubinsky will drive the net. Trying to feed it in front. It's broken up. Under 4 to go. Lombardi splitting the defense, but the engineers recover. Good stick there by Baxter. Now Dubinsky to the slot. He lost the handle to the point where he keeps it in. And they're going to blow this one down for offside.
Yeah.
And a bit of a disagreement there between the RPI bench.
You don't win those.
And Adam Woods. Yeah.
I think it wasn't the bench. I think it was Dubinsky.
Oh, okay.
He was coming off. He said, I don't think that was offside. Probably not like that.
Yeah, well. That was a nice way to put it.
Like I always told the players, you're entitled to your opinion.
This is not going to be icing here. Sturdy ahead for Seller.
Now Coach Smith is probably thinking, all right.
If nothing else, they need a bit of a boost offensively, seemingly. Well, they have no goals. They haven't been shut out all year, Engineers. In fact, until last weekend, they hadn't scored fewer than two goals in a game, but then they ran into Devin Levi of Northeastern, and he held them to one in each game.
Well, as Coach Smith has said in his interviews this week, this is a time where you got to try to find a way to get one.
Certainly is. 2.5 to go. Marshall still staying put here. Hallbauer at center. Touch pass for Brackett. Pulls up in the zone. Takes a shot that goes wide. It'll carry him around to the near wall. High in the air. Gloved down by Johnson. Off a mask of Brackett. And they lose sight of the puck. Now here's Beaton trying to center. He had Adamo, but he missed him with the pass, and Adamo just runs a man over. Beaton in front. One-timer. Oh, no. Another stop there as Brackett was denied on the backhand. Jack Brackett with a glorious opportunity in front.
Wow. That was a heck of a save.
Puck back in. Marshall halfway out of the net. Shots are even at 18 apiece. Now it's tied up in the corner. Bobcats are fine with it there. Now finally dug out by Brackett to the circle. A shot. It takes a deflection. It goes to the near side where Beaton. Got a stick to the stomach there, look like. Now it's over the top of Marshall. He thought about trying to glove it, but lets it go. Dubinsky. 1:14 left. Zach Dubinsky, he'll shoot it in. Marshall goes off. Comes free to Lapinen. Had to settle down a rolling puck. It's still kind of not flat for him. Lapinen holding it. Back to the point for Baxter. 1 minute left. 6-on-5 here. Trying to move it down low. Is deflected by Van Ness. Around behind for Lapinen. Throwing it in front. There's nobody home. And now Van Ness trying to clear. Empty net for RPI. It's Chow trying to move around Sturdy. Still Chow. Gets a bit of a shove. Throws it at the empty net. It goes across. Now another shot was blocked down by the RPI defense. Lapinen with 31 seconds left, and he'll slow it down. To center. Dumped in by Lapinen. Less trying to clear. And it's out to center ice. Race for the puck. And it's going to be an empty net goal for Oliver Chow. His seventh of the year, and it's 2-0 Quinnipiac with 12.4 seconds to go.
Oliver Chow, another guy from Oakville, Ontario, transferred from UMass. And that, it's funny how the game changes when you have that opportunity. And goaltender comes up big.
Well, we thought RPI with about 10 minutes left was going to get a chance. They actually got two really good opportunities to tie this game. And
they did.
Couldn't quite stick it home.
Yep, no question. They played well.
Yeah, 7 seconds left. And RPI will just run things out behind their own goal. Another maybe a little bit frustrating loss the way you played against another top 20 team. Again, for all intents and purposes, it was another one-goal game with Quinnipiac adding the late empty netter here. 2-0 is the final. The Bobcats unbeaten in 10 straight games now. They are the hottest team, one of the hottest teams in all of college hockey, certainly in the league, as they pick up their fourth league win. RPI drops to 3-4 in the conference. And Integers are now 6-8-2 overall. Bobcats 11-1-3. Coach, shots were just about even. The only difference there was an empty net goal. Made it 19 shots for the Bobcats, 18 for RPI. Both teams 0-3 on the power play. Faceoffs almost dead even as well. Quinnipiac 25-24 in the dot. It was a very even game again. But again, the Engineers find themselves on the wrong side of things. You know, they can't be happy with that aspect of it, but we saw the way they played in 2019-20. There was a lot of close games that they lost in the first half of the year, if you will, but those turned into wins in the second half, and that's maybe what this team can look to.
Well, you know what? You go through those growing pains as a program and as a group collectively, and what you try to do is continue to grow, and that's the next step in the process here, is to find a way to get that equalizer in these tight games against these top teams. And it's early yet. You know, we're still in the first half of the season, and hopefully, as you say, that's something that comes around, and that's part of the growth that this team is looking for at this point.
RPI is in action tomorrow against Princeton. You can watch that game right here, RPI TV and ESPN. For our entire RPI TV crew and Dan Fridgen, my partner here, I'm Perry Lascaris. We thank you again for watching tonight's game. Your final score from the Houston Fieldhouse, it was the number 4 Bobcats 2 and the Engineers nothing. You've been watching live coverage of RPI hockey.
One last thing. Yeah. Good luck to the football game tomorrow.
Oh, my goodness. How do we forget? Good luck to the Engineers. RPI football. They are taking on the number 1 team in the country, North Central. It's a 1 o'clock Eastern kickoff. I don't know how I failed to mention that, but we'll all be watching intently as the Engineers are playing in the NCAA quarterfinals against North Central Cardinals.
Go be great, boys.
Absolutely. That'll do it for us here at the Fieldhouse, RPI TV and ESPN. We thank you for watching.